The film you're about to see in its entirety was made by Brother Harry Hay. It is entitled A Holiday in Israel in 1932. It was felt that it could be of interest to those who have been fortunate to visit Israel, and even those who haven't, to appreciate the changes that have taken place. Brother Harry Hay was born in 1897. He was baptised in Birmingham in 1915 and belonged to the Birmingham Central and then the Small Heath ecclesias. He transferred to Newark ecclesia in 1941 and was a member here until his death in September 1988, aged 91. Brother Harry made this black and white film of his holiday in Israel in 1932, 86 years ago, early days of home movies, and well before the establishment of the State of Israel on May the 14th in 1948. For most of these 85 years, the film was stored in a box. Harry's son, John, inherited the box along with other of his father's possessions, and it was taken to Scotland when John and his wife Yvonne moved there. About 6 years ago, John had the film converted into a DVD. Shortly after it was made into a DVD, John and his wife, Yvonne, were walking along the street in Edinburgh when they were stopped by a passing motorist. The lady who stopped them was a little agitated as she did not know Edinburgh, and she was due to give a lecture in a public building, but was lost. John and Yvonne suggested they go with her in her car and guide her to a destination. She accepted their offer, and as they chatted, she said she was from Jerusalem. They mentioned their recently converted film, taken in 1932, and she was very interested, as she was a historian. She gave them her address and dashed off to give the lecture. John sent her a copy of the DVD, and she was delighted with it. And with John's permission, it is now officially archived in Jerusalem as a record of social and historical interest. Enjoy the film.
It suits my present purpose to write of my experiences in Palestine in a very general way, and to leave out of particular account all those incidents which would necessitate some ornamentation to make them tell a complete story with data of unimpeachable authority. My mind reacts to pictorial sensations in line and colour rather than to historical or to international associations. And it is to those sensations that I turn to give you something out of the storehouse of my memory. The first port of call was Malta. We approached this island with very pleasurable anticipations. Our first contact with Bible lands would be where the Apostle Paul had preached, Malta being the Melita of Acts 28.
Thank you.
It is the only Jewish city in the world, and racial pride is manifested everywhere. Thank you. atmosphere teemed with emotion. Suddenly, a silence fell upon this vast crowd, and there could be seen, making their way through an entrance on the east side of the stadium, the first ranks of a procession comprising 7,000 athletes, Jews from every country and of every nation. The stadium. This was an erection something like Wembley, but on a much smaller scale. It had been prepared by the Jews and Jewesses of Palestine, many of whom, both sexes, had been engaged in hard manual labour, excavating and levelling in the making of a highway from the city, as well as building the stands and fencing. Over the stand itself, towering above all others from the centre, was the Union Jack. On either side were flags of Jewry, showing the shield of David. Around the oval were gathered about 30,000 onlookers, representative of the peoples of Palestine. These 7,000 athletes, brought from the four corners of the earth, displaying their prowess unimpeded and unmolested in their own land, completed the picture given to Ezekiel in his vision of the valley of dry bones. Here, for all the world to see, is a nation, oft-times considered as dead, alive and standing upon its feet, an exceeding great army. It filled our hearts that we had been permitted to see this, an event unique in the history of the world. With the members of the British contingent to the Maccabiah was an event that attracted much attention. After introductions and other amenities had concluded, we were taken by motor bus to our hotel. Thank you. commercial institutions, its hotels, its shops and fine thoroughfares, with life and bustling activity permeating the whole, make Tel Aviv one of the wonders of our time. In 1909, a sand dune. In 1932, a city of 50,000 inhabitants, constantly enlarging its borders. By such enthusiasm is Palestine being rebuilt. One day was occupied in visiting settlements within a 25-mile radius of Tel Aviv. Three of them were particularly outstanding. The first, Gan Hasharon, developed by Jews previously farming in Canada. The fragrance of the orange blossoms has to be inhaled to be fully appreciated. It seemed to linger and gain in loveliness. Secondly, Tel Mond. As the name implies, this colony was commenced by the late Lord Melchett, and it is being continued by his daughter. Nearly the whole of the colonists turn out to meet and to welcome us. With almost the same pleasure of newly married people, they delighted to show us over their possessions. Situated right away from all other settlements, this is the property of a London Jew. We were informed that the owner, a very keen Zionist, was eager to demonstrate the potentialities of Palestine and thus have a concrete example to exhibit to his fellow Jews. He has literally made the desert to blossom like the rose, and of all the settlements, Kalmania conspicuously remains in our memories. In many respects, it was a little bit of old England. Its dairy farm, its rose arbour, its orchard and its strawberry beds all have their replicas in the English counties. And yet, we still have the fruits of the East. Vines, oranges, tobacco and bananas. Bountifully responding to the labours of man, man in his turn is aided by the wonderful climate. Thank you. Fitek Tikva. An invitation was received the next day to accompany the Jewish members of the party to Petach Tikva. This was founded in the year 1878 by Jews from Jerusalem. It is the oldest agricultural settlement in Palestine and is now a flourishing colony of about 8,000 inhabitants. Most, if not all, of the success attained is directly traceable to its leaders. In this direction, it has been very happy in its connection with the Shapira family. The third generation are now maintaining the wonderful tradition for energy, enthusiasm, and enterprise set by their esteemed grandfather. Israel, the hope of Israel, a school of agriculture which was founded when Zionism first received any practical support in 1870. This school, which is a practical college where prospective farmers are given theoretical and practical tuition over a period of years, possesses a unique museum forming a useful partnership with the laboratory. The farm there was beautifully kept and was exceptionally interesting. Eager and anxious to go to Jerusalem. By motor car, we took the road to Bethlehem. The road gradually climbed. Looking away on our left across the valley, we could see the fields which once belonged to Boaz, the forerunner of David. Boaz lived at Bethlehem, and there appears to be very good reasons for believing that the present site of the Church of the Nativity covers the ground upon which the house of Boaz once stood. Nothing about the quality of the bathing in this heavy water. Nothing from practical experience, I mean, as I was so busy photographing others enjoying themselves in that way. Some received an unpleasant surprise with nose bleeding, caused by the action of the mineral content which they had inhaled. On the whole, it seemed to be very refreshing. We were hot out of the water, and I have no doubt that the dip was beneficial. We also visited the Garden of Gethsemane. In the quietude of that garden, we felt we were with Jesus. His prayer and his agony all came vividly to our recollection. If it had been possible, we would have read together the 17th chapter of John's Gospel. Thank you. leaving Tiberias, we journeyed southward to encompass the whole of the valley of Megiddo, or Emek Israel. Commencing at Dagania Colony, where the Jordan leaves the Sea of Galilee, we travelled over a partly made road running through an undeveloped area, bounded by the river on the one side and the railway from Haifa on the other. The Rutenberg Hydroelectric Works. We at last came to the confluence of the River Jordan with the Yarmouk. The latter river rises in Syria, joining the Jordan about 30 miles above the Dead Sea. At this meeting place, a reservoir has been constructed, and by the way of two pipelines, the waters rush down into the Rutenberg powerhouse and operate two turbines, which already are providing electrical current for industrial, lighting and irrigation purposes in the greater part of Palestine. Still bearing southward, we eventually reached the present-day Arab village of Beth Shan, where Saul's body was fastened to the city walls. While slowly making our way through the squalor of the main thoroughfare, we had considerable trouble to connect this place with what must have been an important Philistine stronghold in the days of Israel's first king. Quite so joyously happy as Nahalal. Glad the heart of man, and what wonderful and marvellous promise it gave of the future, when God shall make her like Eden, like the garden of the Lord. Completing our encircling of the Emek Israel, the Valley of Megiddo, we left that scene of agricultural activity and came to one which was mostly industrial. Haifa. So far, the town itself is lacking in attractions, presumably because the Arabs, who constitute the larger portion of the inhabitants, occupy the districts in which the harbour and the railway station are situated. Few of the Jews reside in the old city, the majority making their homes in the suburbs on and around Mount Carmel. Constantly being heard at the athletic meeting at Tel Aviv, "All we Jews are brothers," was here demonstrated as a truth. For all of us were treated like members of one united happy family, gathered together after a very long parting. And as we joined hand in hand under that beautiful blue sky with the sun shining in its splendor, we imagined ourselves attending a Feast of Tabernacles.